Top 40 radio hits, platinum album sales, international festivals, playing world tours. Every artist dreams of accomplishing all of the above and are fortunate to achieve one. Renee Neufville's resume has them all checked off as a member of the iconic R&B soul duo ZHANE and as vocalist and keyboardist with Roy Hargrove's RH Factor. Renee is reinventing herself with her next career move, the creation of her own band and the recording of her solo debut. Though influenced by R&B, pop, jazz, and even dancehall, Renee defies labels, calling her sound music. Pure, but far from simple. I'm your host, Tembisa M. Shaka. Keep it right here for an hour of her stellar, unrestricted vibrations in performance and in conversation, right here on B-Side. Chat it up for a little bit. Hey, Renee.
Hi.
Looking amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. So, you know it's all about Brooklynite.
Yes.
So tell us how being from Brooklyn has inspired your creativity.
Oh, well, ironically, I learned how to play the piano at the Brooklyn School of Music, which is a block away from BRIC TV. So being here is a self-actualization for me, being a Brooklyn native, being born and raised in this town. When it really was a real village, you know, before the eyes were really on us. Yeah. It's surreal. Every Saturday morning, Dad would bring me around here. And so I grew up in East Flatbush, which is a predominantly West Indian neighborhood. I don't know if you're out there, but so I grew up right across the street from Tilden High School. And so my neighborhood and my roots and culture were Jamaican. Really informed a lot of the writing and a lot of my sense of melody.
Do you feel like it's equal parts, the Caribbean background and the Brooklyn background, or does one?
I would say that because, see, Brooklyn is a melting pot, so it's not just about the Caribbean here.
Yeah.
You know, especially growing up in that era, you had first generation Italians, first generation Puerto Ricans, the Jewish community was thriving, and we all lived together. So you go to school, you buy the knish, you know, at lunchtime you had a real authentic slice of pizza. You know what I'm saying? And then at night you get a beef patty with cocoa bread.
Right, that's right. You know what I
mean? So that was the true, and we all went to school together, you know, we ate matzah during, you know, the season right before Easter, you know. It was really a true melting pot. I love culture. And so that's why I never strayed far from home.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about ZHANE.
Yes.
Wow, I mean, platinum albums, top 40 hits, touring the world.
Thank you.
What was it like to have so much success during such a fertile time for R&B music? But, you know, in the 90s, it was like the diversity of voices, I mean, not just in hip-hop, but in R&B as well. Talk a little bit about that, you know.
Well, I have to say that the 90s were a lot of fun. You had people like Mary J. Blige burgeoning in the scene at the same time with... you know, ZHANE and Biggie, and it's especially here in New York City, most of the record labels were here. So you can go downtown or you go to like Midtown and you'd run into Dante, who is now known as Mos Def, who's now known as Asim Bey, and he'd be on his way to the studio with Rashid, who we know as Common, and then, you know, Pasta Noose, my friend, would say, Renee, come on, I got a track, and ZHANE would come in. I mean, we were all like, it was like being in high school, right. Freshman, senior, junior. Everyone was like in one school, and it was New York City. So, and there was a healthy competition between artists where, you know, everyone wanted to impress, you know, everyone else. So Busta would always want to impress Tribe. And it was just like, it was just very inspiring. And we all really did it for the love at the time, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So when the ZHANE period of your life started to wind down, mm-hmm. what was the thought process of what you would do next?
I was like, well, you know, my partner, my beautiful partner, wanted to pursue her solo career. It was back in 1999, 2000. So when she left the group to go solo then, I wasn't really interested in a solo career at the time. So what I did was I went right back to writing and back to the keyboard and learned how to sort of use my equipment to produce some sounds because I wanted to know what my sound would be like standing alone. Mm-hmm. I think by my nature, I really am an extroverted introvert. So I'm really not the type to say, let's do a show and look at me. No. So it took me a while. During that process, I met Roy Hargrove, who he arranged all the horns for D'Angelo, and I had a song that I was trying to get to D'Angelo, but I didn't know him. So when Roy heard a lot of the material that I was writing, he was like, oh, hell no, look, I have this thing, and it's called Arts Factor, and I really would like to open up a slot for you to perform on it. And so I recorded a song called Juicy, which is a song that we're going to perform tonight for you guys. And then I became one of the musicians in his band. And 3 albums later, 2 Grammy nominations later, we've toured the world in that particular outfit. So it was kind of like my apprenticeship and a blessing in disguise, really. You know?
We're going to talk a little bit about RH Factor later.
Okay.
Yes, because that is juicy for sure. So tell us, introduce us to your amazing band.
Okay.
Sounds so good.
Well, I would like to start with the bass player, and his name is Kyle Miles. And then on guitar, we have Marvin Dolly. On trombone, he's off tour with Lauryn Hill, but his name is Matthew Hartnett. Yes. On keyboards, and my musical director, Chad Self. On trumpet, we have J.S. Williams. To my left, this lovely lady is Ricky Stevens. And to her left, we have Noelle Whippler. And to my right, she's also playing on my latest recording, Watching Me, Courtney Rose. And behind me, vocalist and drummer, Tim Smith.
All right, so set up the next song for us.
Okay, well, the next song is an original, and it's called All I Really Wanted. And basically, it tells the story of a woman who is in a relationship with her guy, And for some reason, he has a difficulty and a challenge to give her his undivided love, and she has to leave. You know, and she's recalling how it began and where they are now. Okay, and it's called All I Really Wanted, and it gets loud, so brace yourself.
All right.
And it's also, a lot of this material I wrote, produced, and arranged in the home, and then this collective of musicians has brought it to life for me so that we could present it for you. Thank you.
Was it fantasy, or did we have love? When you came to me, I knew I was stuck, love. We were in a dream, we both fell in love. We'll spit you out after you chewed up. All I really wanted was all your undivided love. That was all this woman wanted. That is all that was it fantasy, or did we have love, babe? When you came to me, I knew I was the love. We were in a dream, we both fell in love, yes. Love will spit you out, chewed up. All I really wanted was your undivided love. That was all this woman wanted. That's all I really wanted, yeah. That is all I
All right, so can we have a little bit of a conversation about craft? Because you are one of these artists who is committed to the craft. You know, I had no idea that you were a keyboardist. Like, I came to know you as a vocalist. So just to know that you were a pianist and were on keys with Roy, like, you know, talk a little bit about developing yourself as a craftsperson with music. Like, did you study composition or, you know, what was your vocal training like early on? Because ZHANE came about while you were at Temple, right?
Right. So basically, I started at the age of 5, like I said, and studied classical piano at the Brooklyn School of Music, after which I went to Midwood High School in Flatbush, and then accompanied the gospel choir there and the mixed chorus. So I was doing everything from show tunes to classical pieces, and then to like Winans and the commission and groups like that during that time. And that was really when I fell in love with music, because I was weaning myself from the score and then began to write. I wrote my first song at 15. And so I think at the point where the instrument felt like an extension of me as opposed to just a tool that I know how to use, that was really when I honed in and just used it as a creative extension, you know? And so that's, and then meeting Roy and being exposed to like all the music that he plays with his quintet and through RH Factor, it just kind of like helped inform. I feel like in life, as you grow, you just keep adding layers and layers and layers onto yourself, but then at a point you do come back to you, your essence, you know? You have to kind of not shed, but it's important not to just become a clone each and every time you're around a certain thing and reconfiguring yourself. At some point you still have to come back to your essence and bringing all those influences just to enhance who you
are. So share a little bit about who your influences are.
Well, it started out with, I would say, lovers rock, because my brothers, who were both born in Jamaica, when we did our chores, they would play Dennis Brown and all those people in the home. And so melody was always paramount in my home, and Dad would buy, you know, Bob Marley tunes and stuff like that. So I would say it started there. And then I grew up in Brooklyn during the hip hop era, you know, where it was born. And I was just with Kool Herc last night, the founder of hip hop. And it's kind of ironic, I ended up writing Hey Mr. DJ for DJs. Right. So I had to talk to him and I said, listen, Mr. Jamaican, to him, I said, thank you for starting.
Right.
We did write that tune. Mm-hmm. Can I shake your hand? So he, you know, I shook his hand, and that's also very much who I am. No, that's very much who I am. I grew up in that. And then the disco era is also a time that I grew up in. So Chic and Patrice Rushen, and I love Joy Sims, who just followed me on Twitter two weeks ago. I can't even believe that, like, Joy Sims, she heard the new song. Sims.
Come and share my life.
I love her so much. You know, and that was like the New York experience, New York radio, you know, the groove. And then, you know, later on, Anita Baker, and then hearing harmonies, jazz harmonies and stuff like that. So
I want people to really get a sense of who you are as a collaborator, as a songwriter, and as a producer. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, the work that you've done with some of the other artists that they may be familiar with? Because so often women in our business are just seen as vocalists. Not that that is, you know, a slackish thing by any means, because it takes a lot of work. But they don't also realize that, you know, they're actually building music and creating content as well, and not just performing it. Mm-hmm. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Okay, so to be honest with you, sometimes I do forget the work that I've done, because I've always made it a point not to get stuck on yesterday. I mean, even like plaques and awards and stuff like that, I don't even have. I gave them to my parents, and they're somewhere, because I never wanted a constant reminder of, you did this, you used to be that, you know? And that's why I love the young people, because I surround myself from the young and the fresh and the new. Mm-hmm. But if I can, let me try. Okay,
Aaliyah, top three.
Aaliyah, I've written for her, a few of her songs. I'm on the, I've written with Will Downey, I've written for Lila James along with Kanye West. The first recording was with Will Smith, on the Home Base album. I've scored a film that won the American Black Film Festival called 1 Week. Let's see. Of course, the collaborations with Roy are part of my legacy, so there are a few songs that are gonna go down and outlive us. Mm-hmm. I've written, of course, for Busta and with him. So everywhere from like I'm hoping to write with Chronix. I want to do some more reggae. But everywhere from like jazz to hip hop to R&B, Will Downing, who else?
Oh, that's a
nice
list.
I've written with Omar from London.
Oh, who I love, yes.
I had a one writing session with Roberta Flack.
Wow.
Yeah, at her house.
Amazing.
Yeah.
You remembered quite a few. But that's how long the list is that you can't remember a whole bunch of stuff that, you know, or, you know, so.
It's the brain I get old now. The brain I get old.
So, all right, let's get back to the music. We got two songs coming, right? So set us up for
what are we doing?
The next two.
And we're gonna do two. Okay, so the first song is actually the song that I recorded with Roy Hargrove the day after I met him. He just put me right into the studio, and I think I wrote it on the spot along with him. It's called Juicy, and then we're gonna do Is It Love? Because it's Valentine's Day.
See, y'all on the stoop and watching via live stream, you can't see, but the shoes are off, so it's about to get real.
I was gonna tell them that.
I'm just letting y'all know that it's really real. It's going down in here. So if you can't feel it, just know that it's really real. We're in the zone here.
We're in the zone here.
On B-side.
Yeah. Okay, so we're gonna do Juicy. It's gonna feature Matthew Hartnett. Yeah, let's do it.
You're distracting me, but I won't fight it, no, 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 no. Baby, I will give you a call. I got this thing and I wanna use it, oh yeah. You're juicy like a Georgia peach, yeah. But that day, you got me feeling. Beautiful. tangerine. You're distracting me, but I won't fight it, no. Fight it, no, no, no. Maybe I will give you a call. I got this thing and I wanna use it. Oh. But I won't fight it, no. No fighting, no, no, no. Maybe I will give you a call. I got this thing and I wanna use it. Oh, yeah. You're juicy like a Georgia peach, yeah. But I'm bone. You got me. You got me feeling. For the lovers,
Valentine's Day, those that are looking, those that are not looking, those that just lost it, just know this.
I want to love you and to reach you right. I want to love you every day. And every night we'll be together with the rooftop over our head. We'll build a shelter of my single bed. We'll share the same room, 'cause Jah provide the bread. Is this love? Is this love? Is this love? Is this love that I'm feeling? Is this love, 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 love that I'm feeling? Whoa, 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 wow, wow, yeah. Hey, I want to know now. So I put my cards on the table, yeah. I want to love you, I want to love and treat you right. I want to love you every day and every night. We'll be together, together with the rooftop. Over our head, we'll build a shelter, yeah, 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 of my single bed. We'll share the same room, same. so I put my coat on. I want to love you, I want to love and treat you right. I want to love you every day
and every night.
I want to love, treat you right. I want to love you, yeah, every day
and every night.
We'll be together, gather with the rooftop over our head. We'll build a shelter, yes, where on my single bed. We'll share the same room, same room, cause Jah provides the bread. We'll share the same room, yes, cause Jah provides the bread. Is this love that I'm feeling? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Cause Jah provides the bread. Is it love?
Jah provides the bread.
Baby, it's love, yes.
Woo. It's just, I'm just mesmerized watching you because you can tell that you're just so comfortable on stage and performing. And I'm sure that a lot of that has to do with all the time you spent on the road. So if you could, you know, share a little bit about the difference between touring, you know, earlier on as part of ZHANE, mm-hmm. and then coming back around and touring with Roy, and you know, maybe some of the things that you learned as a performer out of both of those experiences.
I think I learned a true sense of abandonment with Roy and RH Factor because of the nature of that music, mm-hmm. and the stages and the being in places where I was an anonymous face. They were not aware of the group. They just saw this woman, Renee Neufville, and they just had to get used to her. And so every night I had to prove myself to an audience that didn't belong to me, which strengthened me and built my confidence level. And also what I did learn through touring with RH Factor and Roy Hargrove is with his fearlessness and his, I would say dexterity and his strength, he would keep going. He would, we'd play and then there'd be a jam session, whether it was in Paris or Germany, and it didn't matter what kind of music you played, you know, he'd go in and get on the stage and do his thing. He didn't really, he wasn't a music snob. As good as he is, as great as he is, he's not a music snob, and that's something that I appreciated, and that's something that I admire in people that can just kind of look at all genres of music and understand that, you know, take the ego out of the music and do it for the people, you know? Yeah, you can play, you can sing, and you can do all these things, but really, why are you doing this music? Are you doing it for yourself? Are you doing it for the people that paid to come and see you? And so that's something that I learned from him and understood that that's what gave him the longevity that he has today.
Can you share a little bit in detail, like how you guys met? Because I know you were talking about wanting to get a song to D'Angelo, yeah. but yeah,
that's how it happened. I want to say maybe Alan Leeds, who was working with D'Angelo at the time, knew I was trying to get a song to Roy and or maybe it was Rashad Smith, one of the two, introduced me to Roy. And I just gave him the music. And from there, he took it and did what he will with it. I mean, it never got to D'Angelo.
Because he was like, I want this.
Yeah.
He just,
you know, the thing with him is that he just has, you know, a giving heart in terms of music. Like, he is just open. And he was doing a project that was stretching the boundaries a bit. Erykah Badu was on this record. It was called Hardgroove. Mm-hmm. Anthony Hamilton, Michelle and Negicello, myself, Common, Q-Tip. It was like a lot of, you know, different people. And so at that point in time, it sort of kind of was timely, I guess.
So who are you listening to right now? Like, who's in your playlist, you know, that you zone out to? I mean, whether they're current artists or, you know, somebody that you are listening to from a different point in time, but, you know, they sort of feed you creatively or, you know, feed your spirit when you don't necessarily have to be working, like.
You know, to be honest, I like, I like everyone from Omar Lifouk to Formation, I just, I enjoy stepping outside of my comfort zone all the time because it can only make me better. So I like to listen to a lot of the new material. One of my favorite older singers is Shirley Horn, who I met years ago before she passed. But her music always takes me to a very comforting place. I love the way she comped and she didn't overdo things. She just kind of like, she's very tasteful. She was with Miles Davis and it was just.
She had a beautiful touch
beautiful
on piano.
Yeah, very delicate. In terms of a rock steady and like reggae, I would say Dennis Brown is one of my favorites. I love, love Lauryn Hill. Goodness, there's so many.
See, right now I'm stuck on Mint Condition. I don't know what it is, but I kind of felt like I needed to go back to
Mint Condition.
An R&B band.
I was,
you know,
listening to Mint Condition last week Sunday.
I'm kind of in that zone right now.
Yeah.
But yes, Formation, feeling that
forever
too.
Forever in your eyes.
So fine. Yeah, man.
Yeah, those are beautiful. For those records, those albums really marked a time for me though, because those are albums that I would obsess over, and so it would just put me in a space and time.
Yeah. And that they mark arrangement as being important, you know, not just verse, hook, verse,
no,
out. Like, we're going to actually.
As a matter of fact, there's this band called Freelance that's like part of, with me, some of the members are with me, and they kind of remind me of that kind of stretch. You know, you got Tim, you got Chad, and are you? Well, sometimes. Well, anyway, they kind of stretch.
You might want to come along,
that,
brother.
They're actually bringing that spirit back to the current generation as well. So it's still vibrant and relevant style of music.
All right, so set up the next one for us.
Okay. Crush. Okay, so I'm going to do a ZHANE song, a song that I wrote on the corner of 42nd Street and 10th Avenue in my car one day.
And while they're getting into it, silence your phones, people. It's live TV.
Sunshine in my day, something to wash away my pain. I saw a very gentle side of him that took my heart and made it sing. I wish he'd run away and hide with me. Love hurts so much more than it seems. There was one thing I did not show. I love a man who doesn't know. I wonder if I ever see the day. Will I ever find the words to say I love you? And if will he turn around, walk away? Will he leave or will he stay? If I tell. Was in my dream. Could seal it tight, send it overnight, sending my love to you. I'm sending my love, baby, yeah, yeah, to you. Sunshine in my day to wash away my pain. Yeah, crush.
Yes, thank you for taking us back to that golden era, the golden time of ZHANE. So yes, you're aging in reverse, but it's been a solid couple decades in this business.
Aging in reverse,
but yes, girl, you look great. You look great.
Thank you, but I'm not aging. Thank you.
And we embrace the maturity, but you know, it don't crack.
Oh.
So, tell us, what are some of the biggest and or most valuable lessons that you've gotten on the business side of things?
Yeah,
from your time in our industry?
I think that one of the best things I've learned is openness. And the best thing you can do in this business is to believe in yourself. You really don't need you don't need people to really rally behind you so much. So when you do believe in you, another thing is that, getting back to the music, when I asked myself, "Oh, Renee, if you're gonna do this music, who are you doing it for? Are you doing it to just like feed yourself, or are you trying to feed people? Are you trying to like reach people?" That was one of the best things that I could have done, because it will always allow me to bend genres, and it always allow me to, you know, reach different cultures and different age groups and so on and so forth. I like that malleability. I like that freedom.
But how do you negotiate the two? Because so much of artistry is the audience experiencing you, your experiences, your interpretations of the things that, you know, connect us all as human beings. So, you know, in terms of, there's, yes, giving people what they want, but then giving people what they may not know they even need.
Well, all right? You have to do is stay human. You know, stay human.
Is that part of the openness?
Stay human within the music. Mm-hmm. If you think about people, you know, like Earth, Wind, and Fire, and the messages that they would share, it was very human-based, you know. Bob Marley, it was human-based. You know, stay human. Keep your heart in it.
Mm-hmm.
People will feel that. They know when you're tight. They feel it. It's an energy, you know, and I'm a bit of an empath. I'm very affected by energies around me, whether I tell you or not. I always feel it. I see it. I know it. And so I made a decision that if I'm going to be any kind of energy through the music, I want it to feel good for as long as I can feel good. No matter how old I'm getting, I want to leave this earth feeling inside good. You know,
so let's talk a little bit about the self-care aspect of it. Like, how do you protect yourself in this business? Because it can be draining, and it can be, you know, really exacting in terms of like, well, look, these are the things that you have to do, right? You know, whenever you ramp up on a new project, or whenever you commit to recording, or whenever you hit the road, like, how do you take care of yourself in the face of all that?
I stay prayed up, I mean, every day. Mm-hmm. And I always... I refer to my gut instincts with everything that I'm doing, and I try not to panic, because I know that I'm really not in control. I'm not in control. When I look around and I see all of you here and all of these people behind me, I mean, if I ask myself, how am I doing this? I don't know. You know, I burned my finger yesterday. I locked my keys in my car yesterday. I lost my phone 2 days ago. There's a lot of things that I've gone through, you know, in the last few months. And I'm like, how am I going? And I realize I freed myself from that responsibility, because his will be done.
That's so right.
And so that's just how I feel. That's how I go. through.
And so now it's Renee Neufville, solo artist, band leader.
Yes, but I'm not solo. I have 8 people on stage with me.
Well,
I'm not
yes,
by myself.
Right.
I'm not alone. Right?
Look, yeah, Courtney, I mean, right. We never do these things ourselves, right? But, you know, band leader, right? Front woman, right? This is now you. This is not you as part of something else, right? Part of a duo or part of, you know, another front man's group.
Yeah.
So, let's talk a little bit about that.
Okay, my disclaimer. Can I just, this is what makes me comfortable.
Disclaimer?
Yeah.
You don't need any disclaimers.
No, this is what I'm saying.
Okay.
Everything I've done in the past is going to be a part of the legacy in the future. So I bring all of it. I bring Gene with me. I bring Roy with me. Everybody is on the stage with me, and I'm singing those songs. I'm doing that material. I don't abandon. I'm not ashamed of any aspect of my musical career.
Oh, yeah, no, this is just the next.
Yeah, know what I'm saying? Look, I honor every phase of it. And so for me, what makes me comfortable is to say, well, I'm still carrying their spirits with me.
So tell me about that album. We're gonna step you out a little bit.
Okay.
Okay, talk about the solo album itself. Like, well, musically, what can we expect? And where were you creatively when these songs came to you? You know, was there an inciting incident? Was there something that was like, okay, this is going to be the theme of this record, or this is the approach I want to take with this record?
To be honest, a lot of the material has already been written, but I want to do some more writing. I think the title of this album will be Sovereign. And because freedom is what makes me happy. Some of the songs are born out of heartache, and other songs are born out of freedom and happiness. There's one song in particular called I Am that I wrote specifically for the people, which is a reaffirming song, because I realized that we're all kind of going through, you know, some kind of challenge, whether it's personal, whether it's monetary or whatever, and I think that we don't have enough material like that to speak to us. So I Am is dedicated to the people now. And then, you know, some of that feel-good music is coming back, like Watching Me, because we can't get enough of that,
right?
In that classic vibe. And then there'll be some, you know, ballady songs on the piano and just vocal. Just it'll be informed by every experience I've had musically from the beginning until now. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So what's the next joint we're going to hear right now? Is that something from Sovereign that you're going to play for us now? Or?
No, this song is actually on the radio.
Okay.
Right. Where are we? What are we doing? No. No. This one is on the radio. It was released in October, and it's now number 12 on adult contemporary radio. It's in heavy rotation without a label, which I am so grateful
All right.
for. Mike Burrell is a good friend of mine, and he and actually Chuck Chillout from legendary Chuck Chillout,
yes.
They both heard these songs. I mean, anybody that knows me knows that Renee's been reluctantly releasing material, because like I'm an extroverted introvert. I can very well be okay behind the scene, but it was like, come on, just put something out. And so I've had the song for a while, and they remembered. And in August, Mike asked me if he could, you know, hear it again, and next thing I knew, WBLS heard it, and then now it's a part of the system. It's on DAS in Philly, and it's charting, and it's just a song to remind us, those who were around in the golden era, that it's okay to still feel grown, it still feels sexy, and still feel good, and that's all. It's just a feel-good classic sound.
And the title is?
Watching Me, and it's available on iTunes.
All right. Support the music you want to hear.
Thank you.
That's it.
All right, so let's do it, guys.
Mm-hmm.
take it back. Let's see if you remember this tune. Goes together with the beat in your soul. Did I ever tell you how you make me feel? Every night you're on the control. So come on, daddy, won't you take it away? I know I call your line every day. I'm dialing 555 so that I can hear you say, hey, baby boo, just tell me what I can play for you, you. You're right on time. What is it? You just got through the request line. Let's do the baby's part, come on. Baby. Come on. Baby. Come on. Me. Thank you.
Such a remarkable illustration of melodic intensity and artistry. Thank you, Renee, for sharing your sonic bounty with us and for bringing us along on a journey of soulful storytelling. Now, after tonight, you're going to want to keep up with Renee on Twitter at Renee Neufville. That's Renee, R-E-N-N-R-E-N-E-E-N-E-U-F-V-I-L-L-E. I'm Tembisa M. Shaka, and I hope you enjoyed this time with us. Be sure to check out this and past episodes anytime at youtube.com/BRICTV. Check in every Thursday to hear more of the best music in Brooklyn. All right, Renee, this is it. Bless us with that voice and close us out with one last song after this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This one is called I Am. For all of you that might have some financial woes, relationship struggles, reaffirming, two words, I am. Cold and I feel my center, oh, I say it. weather out.